My name is James Spann. I am the chief meteorologist for the ABC affiliate in Birmingham, ABC 3340. We're in the problem-solving business. We're trying to solve a problem of determining the state of the atmosphere up to 7 days in advance. So we primarily use computer models. These are dynamic models run by the National Center for Environmental Prediction in Washington, D.C. We take that raw data, we look at current analysis, we go back to analogs, things that have happened in the past with such a situation, and come up with a public forecast. That's the core of what we do. We do that multiple times a day.
Yep. Boy, that's a big tornado. That's huge.
You know, we have two well-defined tornado alleys in the United States. One is traditional tornado alley. That's Oklahoma, Kansas, North Texas. Dixie Alley is it's Alabama and Tennessee and Mississippi. And all along, we've had more strong, violent tornadoes than traditional tornado alley. Not that we want to brag on that, but you just can't see them very well here because they're rain-wrapped and we have terrain issues, and it just doesn't get as much publicity as the other ones because we don't have that good chaser video, I guess.
Phil Campbell 3 to 911. I got rotation coming through Phil Campbell right now. Teddy, run at us! Get someplace safe!
Two of the main ingredients for a tornado outbreak in the Deep South, number one, it's instability. That means air parcels can rise freely and easily, and there's nothing to prevent them from rising all the way to the top of the tropopause. And we had a lot of that. The instability values were just off the chart. There was a period where there was a little capping inversion that prevents those air parcels from rising, but when temperatures heat up, the cap goes away and everything just blows up. The other thing, it's shear. That's the veering of the wind with altitude. The wind's typically at the southeast or at the surface route of the southeast. They veer to the west aloft, and that tends to set the updrafts in motion, the storm updrafts in motion. And those values were excessively high that day. Sometimes you can get too much shear, and that tears the updraft apart, but we thought the updrafts would be so strong and so organized and so violent that they would stay intact. And here in this office, we have a checklist of about 65 parameters that you look for when you're forecasting a major severe weather or a tornado event. And about 60 of them were in place, and that's pretty rare. And of course, the day before is the day that you've got to really work on telling people that there's potential for this, you've got to get ready, you need to think about it and do these things. So we tried to stretch it out across all these different platforms the day before to tell people this could be a really, really bad day.
That's huge. That's a big tornado.
Yeah, it is.
It's hard to describe that unless you've been in it. And you know, it was an EF5. Those are quite rare. Those are only about 1% of all tornadoes in the United States are EF5s, 1 in 100. That's how rare they are. Those typically tend to be long-lasting. They don't get down and lift up. They tend to stay on the ground for dozens and dozens of miles. As it came up through Hackleburg, it was obvious from the reports that this thing was about 1 mile wide on the ground. And the wind velocities in an EF5, and we didn't know it at the time, because radar, the way radar works, the beam is aloft. You know, a tornado's on the ground. So we have an idea of the wind velocities at, say, 3,000-4,000 feet. We didn't know at the time, but it's clear that the wind velocities exceeded 200 miles an hour based on storm reports from the surveys. So you had a one-mile-wide monster that had done catastrophic damage in Hackleburg, crossed the Franklin County line, came up into Phil Campbell and did the same type damage there. Most of the frame homes are taken off the foundation, and when you've got a slab foundation, that's basically all you see left is the slab and some debris, and quite frankly, a lot of the debris is from another house in another part of town, perhaps. It's a clean white. The trees that are left standing, the debarking process is usually very close to being complete. Bark was ripped off the trees. In many cases, grass was scoured from fields, and you can see that very easily from even satellite images. in some cases, asphalt roads. The asphalt was stripped back, just rolled back like a piece of candy. People that were not in an underground bunker did not have a chance to survive in many cases. We don't really say this on the air because it is such a rare event that when people hear us say that, they feel like there's no hope. In 99% of all cases, you're fine if you go to a small interior room in the lowest floor. But in the case of an EF5, unless you're underground, you often don't have much of a chance. And a tornado is a violently rotating updraft. And what happens in a storm like that, those people that are not in an underground bunker, they are taken aloft. It's very graphic, and it's something that we don't like to talk about. I certainly don't, but most people lose their life when they are aloft in the tornado from the shrapnel wounds, because you've got objects within that tornado, pieces of sheet metal and splinters and glass and boards and bricks and nails. And often people, when they are aloft, are impaled with these objects and they don't survive. And by the time they land, they've lost their life. You have a few instances where some people will live through that, which is just a miracle to me. But the loss of life is often just catastrophic. And in many cases, there's nothing you could do unless you are in that underground bunker. And unfortunately, most of us don't have one of those at our house. And there were some people that did the right thing. They heard the warning. They didn't wait. They had a plan. They implemented their plan. They did everything right. And in some cases, people lost their life. It's a horrible situation, but it was just their day. We're doing an extensive study with social scientists to try and figure out why the death toll was so high that day. The death toll statewide was 252. And that is appalling to all of us in this science. I thought the death toll that day should have been about 30. In about 222 cases, there was a small room where these folks could have gone. There was shelter. And we're trying to find out what happened there. Did they not hear the warning? Did they ignore it? Was it apathy? But in the case of Phil Campbell, we thought the response was very good. But I mentioned we thought the death toll should have been about 30. Most of those were Phil Campbell and Hackleberg due to the intensity of the tornado. But the one thing you have to remember, violent tornadoes are very, very rare. That type of tornado is 1 in 100, and tornadoes in themselves are rare. Really rare tornadoes. Hardly any storms have tornadoes. Storms by nature are good. Where we live without them, we'd be in a constant drought. They're a blessing. Thunderstorms are good. Tornadoes are so rare, and the odds of that ever happening again are so small. The statistical odds are just so minute that at some point I'd like to think that maybe the fear will subside, because they're going to go through season after season after season where nothing happens. Will they have close calls? Yeah, but they'll probably be smaller tornadoes. Will there be some damage? Yeah. If you live in Alabama, you'll get some damage after a while. But it's okay to be afraid, but the point comes in your life where you can't run your life based on fear. That's when you make some bad decisions. You run your life based on facts and good information, and the good information is that these things are extremely, extremely rare, and that's good. If you are in a warning, and first off, be sure you're in the warning. The one thing I think people are still confused about, a lot of people think warnings are still based on counties. They're not. They're based on little segments of counties, these polygons. And if you're not in the polygon, you don't need to do anything. That's the beauty of these polygons. Tornadoes, even the big ones, are fairly small compared to a whole county. But if you're clearly in that polygon, the basics are small room, hall, closet, bathroom, lowest floor. If you've got an up and a down, go up, you go down. Near the center, as many walls between you and the outside as you can, and away from windows. That's for a site-built home. A lot of people live in mobile homes in rural areas, and you've got one rule. You've got to leave. You've got to leave. I don't care what anybody says. A mobile home is a death trap during a tornado. They offer wonderful, affordable housing, but they are a death trap, and you've got to leave. If you're in a car, you've got to get out. A car and a mobile home are the two worst places to be. For whatever reason, There are still some people that think today that you should hear an outdoor warning siren. That should be the first way you're going to get a tornado warning. If you're at home, if you are at your business, if you are at church. That's crazy. It's total insanity. This is World War I air raid siren technology, and here we are in 2012 using that. It's not effective at reaching people inside a building. It's horrible. They reach a limited number of people outdoors, and that's it. In their days, I get so discouraged, I just want to take them all down and burn them, and that would force people to do the right thing. But I know that they serve a purpose. They serve a limited number of people. But this mentality of thinking that you're going to hear those things, I'm shocked at the number of well-educated people that think that. And that's what's got to stop. We had a 16-year-old girl that died in Birmingham January 23rd. It was a 4 a.m. tornado, pre-dawn tornado. This was a 16-year-old girl, brilliant, her whole life in front of her, unlimited potential, and she was killed because of the siren mentality. And I'll say this, those parents are now very big advocates for what we're trying to preach, is that you've got to stop it. You've got to stop it. And I don't know why some people still rely on them today, but we're going to be very bold. And I say we, the professional weather community, broadcasters, National Weather Service, emergency managers, we're going to be very bold in coming months and years trying to prevent this issue, the siren mentality, from being a problem. It's going to kill dozens more if we don't stop it. We think the baseline ought to be a weather radio, NOAA weather radio. That is a government service. Is it perfect? No, but it works very well. You program those weather radios by counties. They're not polygon-based yet. That's their greatest limitation, but still, they work well. You program the county where you live, it will sound a loud, and I mean a loud alarm in your home. And that way you know that part of the county is under a tornado warning. You go turn on the television, you find out if you're in the polygon or not, and then you take action according to that. That's what will wake you up at 4 o'clock in the morning. That's what gets your attention when you're not watching television, when your family's having dinner. So that is the baseline. And then beyond that, to me, the beautiful thing we've got are these smartphone apps. With the smartphone app, number one, it knows where you are based on the GPS chip in the phone. So if you're in a polygon warning, you get the warning, you're alarmed. And if you're not, you don't. And in addition to knowing where you are, you can program in fixed locations, multiple fixed locations, your home, your business, your mama's home, whatever. That's where it all needs to go. But on the other hand, we are fully aware that not everybody can afford a smartphone. And quite frankly, there are some that can't afford a $30 weather radio. We've got to be sure that lower income families have ways of getting warnings as well. But the smartphone apps are fantastic. And there's services that call home phones. A lot of people don't have home phones anymore. I don't. But those that do, there are services that call your home phone based on polygons, and you get the warning. A lot of older people like that service because they don't travel as much. They can hear their phone, and it's just beautiful. So above the weather radio, you've got multiple options like the smartphone apps and services that call your home phone that are really, really good. Out of everything else, you know what's been the biggest improvement in terms of our ability to warn people or not warn people if the storm's not severe? It's social media. Everybody has a camera, it seems like, with their phone. Most people have a Facebook account or a Twitter account, and the images that we see in real time during a tornado outbreak are invaluable. We can see there's a wall cloud, but there's nothing underneath that. You know, we can see that the storm is striated. You've got striations. It's a rotating up cloud. You can see damage coming off the rear flank downdraft. The people taking the picture, they probably don't know this, but by golly, we do, and we can see it in real time. And out of all of the things I'd say that have happened over the last couple of years, that's probably the most important, real-time video and images from people that are not trained. And then you've got the trained guys with the live streams, and those are crucial too. I think the two guys that got the live stream of the EF4 below Tuscaloosa, those guys were heroes, and they never got any credit. John Olshue and Ben Greer, you know, they were out there in the middle of nowhere in very difficult terrain showing this EF4, 45 minutes before it came into downtown Tuscaloosa. People will do something if I can show them a live stream. I show them radar, they've seen enough of that. False alarm ratio's out of hand. I think part of the reason so many people died. I think a lot of people ignored the warning, and a lot of it is our fault. The false alarm ratio is out of hand. About 80% of all tornado warnings are false. We've got to fix that. We've got to fix that. If you get warning after warning after warning after warning, and nothing happens, it's human nature. I'm not going to do anything. Those things go off all the time. We've got to stop that. And I'm not faulting the Weather Service. They're doing what they're told to do. Their mandate is to warn for every single tornado. And my position is we're not that good. Most tornadoes are EF0s and EF1s. These are tiny little tornadoes that might last for 60 seconds or 90 seconds. They touch down, they're gone, boom. But yet a warning goes out. By the time the warning goes out, the tornado's gone. We're on TV for 45 minutes and there's nothing out there. It's my position. We got to stop trying to catch those little bitty spin-up tornadoes in a long line. Forget about them. Use a severe thunderstorm warning. Say within the body of the message, these might produce a small spin-up tornado that might last for a minute or two. Let's focus on these big ones that kill most of the people in this state. And if we can do that, I think that people will get serious about it again. Of course, they are now. We have a heightened awareness after what happened, but that'll fade away. But we've got to cut that false alarm ratio back. That is a big problem, and we're working to do that. There's a big dialogue going on now within the professional weather community, and it's all good. We're going to get better. We're still shocked over that day. And as we approach this anniversary, it's harder, because all the memories come back and we're having to look at a lot of stuff I haven't looked at in a long time. And it's just a lot of bad things happened that day. And with every bit of strength in my body for the last part of my career, I'm going to work to make the warning process better. I really am.